introduce you to Dr. Patrick McGovern of the University of Pennsylvania, specializing in biomolecular research of archaeology and alcohol beverages.
Okay, well, I'm very happy to be here to talk about ancient wine. And of course, in order to understand ancient wine, you've got to taste some modern wine, which I'm pleased that we'll be doing that today. And we'll give you sort of a range of different varietals that maybe you're not so accustomed to. And I'm glad we've got some wet weather here. That must be helping the grapes somewhat.
And the people.
Of course, delayed my flight last night, as it turned out, from Philadelphia. I got in a couple hours later. The other Patrick stepped right in and met me at his front door and got a fairly good sleep last night. So I hope as I go along, if anybody has questions, you know, feel free to ask them. And I see we're being watched over by the courthouse here, so I'll try to be as accurate as I possibly can. And see how this all goes. Okay, so we're going backwards or forwards? There, okay. So this is my opening slide, which you know, shows you what humans were capable of 5,000 years ago. So this is from an Egyptian tomb. And these sort of motifs of how wine is made in Egypt, it starts around 2700 BC, and it goes for the next 3,000 years. And there are very few other parts of the world where we have such graphic evidence of how wine was being made. Now, it is a stock motif. It gets repeated over and over again. And, you know, it probably started out, you know, as an eyewitness, you know, looking at how the grapes were grown. And you'll see already at 3000 BC that they have a trellis system, which is pretty amazing, really, because it helps to protect the grapes from the sun in the hot Nile Delta. Now, Egypt did not have any grapes to begin with. It did not have wild grapes. It had to be brought in, probably by the Canaanites, who already had a wine industry up in the Jordan Valley and the environs, going back to 4000 BC. And so they were already pretty expert, you know, at growing grapes. And they would adapt it then from the hilly country of Palestine to the flat plain of the Nile Delta, where you get a lot of sun and you got to do irrigation. And in some cases, we even have, I don't know if this has a pointer, but in some cases, you will have, if this works.
It absorbs lasers.
Oh, is that what it is?
So the laser that I have there shows, but not particularly.
Anyway, I can walk over here.
I don't need technology for this.
And sometimes it actually shows a container right here, which would have been for water to irrigate the plants. And of course, they would have dug out the Nile Delta to plant the vineyards and so on. And then, you know, this is, it makes also for easy picking and so forth. Then it goes into the stomping area, and we do have archaeological evidence of such stomping platforms from the Nile Delta from a later period. And I don't know how many people here have stomped grapes. Okay, quite a few people. I mean, it's a great experience. I did it on the Duero River, the port area, on the Pecos. And, you know, we went through the whole process. And it works very well because the human foot is ideally contoured not to break the seeds. And so you don't get all the tannins coming out. And they rise, they float to the surface, and you just skim them off. And so then, in all these various depictions that we have, it's a red colored juice coming out. But I happen to think of whites because they're rarer and are genetic mutation were probably quite important. When I get to the Haji Firuz Iranian evidence, we have both red and white. And then it was put into a Canaanite jar, as you see here, and sealed off, you know, marked with the year and the name of the pharaoh, and sometimes details on where in the delta the grapes were processed. And so this is already like the earliest wine label going back to 3000 BC. And then the Canaanite jar is very useful. And some people in this audience have written about the Canaanite jar. Al Leonard, back there in the corner, was at our first Mondavi conference and did a really nice chapter on that.
It can be used in boats especially, because it has the contoured bottom, which you can put multiple layers of jars, you know, one intercalcated into another, and just build up layers of the whole ship. And it can be used for wine, but it can be used for olive oil, for all kinds of dry products and so forth. But wine is, you know, generally the most common. And of course, here they're holding onto grapevines to keep from falling, because it is a slippery operation. So this jar gets invented by the Canaanites back around 2000 BC, based on early bronze vessel types that are very similar. And then it gets used for the next couple of thousand years as the principal way of transporting wine by ship, primarily, but also on donkeys. So you just put, you know, two jars on either side of a donkey and, you know, take it out over the desert or wherever you're going. Now, I guess most of you are familiar with Ancient Wine, which is a book I wrote about this first, and it is now being translated into French, which is appropriate, because France is sort of the culmination of the wine culture in our world, because, you know, what we're mostly used to now is, you know, having French cultivars. But we really, and that's a very small selection of what's out there. And that's what, why this conference, I think, is so important, is to try to bring out the ideas about how there's much greater possibilities for how to make wine. We don't have to just limit ourselves to French, although, you know, I like the French wines, of course. But we'll find out a lot more, I think, during the course of today. Then this other book I wrote, Uncorking the Past, which it takes a little bit broader perspective on how wine fits into the alcoholic beverage world in general. And when I say other alcoholic beverages, I'm referring to things that are really extreme or hybrid beverages, where you mix wine, beer, mead together, which we did for Midas Touch back in 2000 based on the evidence in the tomb at Gordian in Turkey, which is thought to be the tomb of Midas or his father, Gordius. You know, at that time, this whole movement of making extreme beverages had not really caught on. I mean, now it's like, you know, I turn around, everybody, you know, I would mention Dogfish, that everybody said, oh, you know, it's like a household word now. Back in 2000, when we first did Midas Touch, I'd say that and everybody kind of goes blank, you know, Dogfish head, what are you talking about? And I don't know if it's penetrated into the wine world yet, that's another question, I guess. But I see some people smiling, okay. So here you have a scene that kind of brings out this combination idea. You know, we're going to talk about, you know, very specific varietal wines, you know, from the Near East today, primarily. But here you've got a gentleman from about 1350 BC with a stela. This is on the cover of the book. A stela showing a scene inside his tomb in which he's obviously drinking a beverage out of a Canaanite jar with a straw. Now, that is typically the way you drink beer. We don't know exactly, you know, what is in this vessel. He's a Semite, so he's certainly familiar. He's got a beard, you know, which makes him a Semitic type. He's wearing Egyptian clothes. He's got a sommelier, to say, as he's holding up his drinking tube. And he's also, you see, the small boy is holding a little jar or something. Now, this could be some kind of a herb. Spice, drug. And there are a lot of possibilities that we've never really figured out, and there's no real textual evidence for this. But, you know, so we have sort of a combination of wine and beer, so just keep that in mind as we go along in talking about these beverages. And then what we do in this book is try to show how a lot of what we are as humans has to do with alcoholic beverages. Because as we were forming our biology and our cultures in Africa, say 100,000 years ago, we really, you know, set ourselves up to drink alcoholic beverages. We have the sensory apparatus, the olfactory and visual taste buds and so forth, to pick up, you know, the aroma of alcohol and other aromatics that are in alcoholic beverages. We have enzymes in our liver. 10% of the enzymes in our liver break alcohol down into energy.
And we really, and then of course get the mind altering effect, which brings humans together. So if you have like a hunter-gatherer situation and you have an alcoholic beverage, it's not just, you know, bringing you down from a hard day's romp out, you know, after mastodons or, you know, or women, you know, picking the berries and so forth, but it also is a way to bring the group together at the end of a hard day. And so it's a social lubricant. Not just wine, but, you know, all the alcoholic beverages. So my theory, and this is still, you know, it's very hard to prove this chemically, is that we were really set up to drink fermented beverages. We just don't have the containers from the Paleolithic period, which are probably organic containers like leather or wood that have been preserved. In fact, we have no containers that have been preserved for 99% of human existence, and we need the containers, like especially pottery, which can absorb ancient organic compounds so you can identify the original ingredients that went into it. So we're sort of at a loss, you know, to get the real, you know, solid chemical evidence, but, you know, based on how we are set up as biological creatures, and it's not just us, you know, fruit flies, elephants, you go through the whole organic world, they're all interested in sugar and alcohol for the most part. Not at all, but, you know, there's various different ways. But you could say that fermentation itself is the original energy system of the planet, you know, going back 2 or 3 billion years, because that was the original energy system that was utilized in all different sorts of biological life. And then also said fermented beverages started the first application of a technology called, you know, biotechnology that humans came up with, at least. That's the sort of hypothesis I'm working off of as we go through this. And then you combine, you know, all this sort of bits and pieces of evidence we have from archaeology, from chemistry, DNA analysis, ancient texts and art, like what I'm showing you here, which, you know, have their own canons of argumentation. You know, when you do a read an ancient text, you're going to have to be familiar with that language and all the possible translations. And that can be a difficult assignment if you're looking at ancient texts like Egyptian or Akkadian. And then ethnography, which sometimes we get a carryover of traditions for thousands of years, it seems. Like, one example, that's because alcoholic beverages are so ingrained in the cultures, you know, socially, religiously, and so on, that you don't really want to change your preferred alcoholic beverage. I mean, you like to have it keep going. So these alcoholic beverages then can be perpetuated for generations. And if you go out and study a people, like in Africa or Georgia, Georgia is a good example because it seems to have perpetuated a wine culture for at least the last, you know, it depends on when you start, you know, get into this a little bit. But, you know, 4,000 or 5,000 years at least. And you know, makes its wine in pottery jars underground, probably. And Armenia fits in here too. They do the same sort of technology that, but it's very integral to their whole culture. It has been for a long time. So if we go and we observe that ourselves, it gives us ideas about how to interpret the archaeological and chemical data. And then we do what's called experimental archaeology, which is actually trying to recreate these beverages. And that's what I've done with Dogfish Head. I have also done some experiments, you know, doing wines, especially resinated wines, in Crete, for instance. We were going to have a serving this one particular wine made from native Cretan grapes and birds and so forth at the World Olympics, the Olympics games that were held in Athens, but it didn't. The herb didn't really work too well. So we gave up on that project. But we've done a lot of others now, and you can read about it on my website. So I mentioned France is where, you know, we used to think of, you know, you think of ancient wine of France, you know, Burgundy and Bordeaux and so forth. And here we've got. You know, Romanée-Conti, perhaps, you know, the most renowned winery in that area, others. But, you know, when you look at the actual
area where it's laid out, there's nothing very particular about it that strikes you. You know, it's just sort of an area going up the low middle slopes of the hills in the Côte d'Or. And, you know, you wouldn't expect that, you know, it produced such good Chardonnay and Pinot Noir. But the Caesarean monks, you know, began working on this 800 or 900 years ago, and they finally, you know, came up with the right place to make it. And now, you know, some bottles, 2005, I suppose, goes for $20,000 today. Or, some of them are quite expensive. But we could go back much earlier than France. And I don't know how many people in this room. I know Al Leonard was at this conference back in 1991 at the Mondavi Winery. And this is when we really got our earliest, I don't know, who else has been, was at the 2001, or at the 1991 conference at the Mondavi Winery? Okay. So I'm not really, you know, repeating a lot of old material. There's some new people here that can pick up on this, but this is when we really announced very early wine identified by chemical analysis looking for tartaric acid. And the woman you see here is Virginia Badler, who worked on a dissertation from Iranian site at Gogin Tepe. Now, Iran is not necessarily thought of as the mecca of winemaking today, right? You know, because they ferment it. But secretly, you know, Christian communities and even Islamic people do make wine still and have a toke of it every now and then. And there is a winemaker for David Bruce Winery, you know, close by here, which is an Iranian named Mitri. If you ever get a chance to go down to the David Bruce Winery, and he will tell you a story, for instance, about, even though he makes excellent Pinot Noir, when he goes back to visit his family in Shiraz, okay, Shiraz being, you know, what we think of as sort of the ultimate ancient grape, I suppose, although it has been kind of taken over by the French and their Syrah and the Australians. The real Shiraz,
Carol Merritt says that Syrah, in fact, is not ancient at all. In fact,
oh, no, no, Syrah, no, no, it's Mandus, Blanche. But no, but what about the real Shiraz? See, that's the question. Nobody has been in there to collect samples of these grapes, partly because wine is outlawed in Iran, and do the DNA analysis that we need to figure out what is distinctive about that Shiraz grape. And Mitri, he said, well, he went there to his family, because they're still making wine secretively in households. What you have is a situation where the stomping out of the grapes is done only by virgin women. Now, this is, I guess, a really purified product. And then the juice is fed down through tubes into the basement, into pottery jars, and the wine is made that way. And he said the Shiraz wine, he doesn't know what the grape is, but the Shiraz grape and wine that he's had is better than any Pinot Noir that he's made. So maybe somebody, you know, just take up some courage and go into real Shiraz and find out what the Shiraz is all about.
Either that or someone has to make Pinot Noir with virgin women.
That would be an experimental archaeology program. I'm ready to try that. So at the conference, you know, we got back to 3500 BC. On the Gogin Tepe Iranian wine. And I might add, too, that when that discovery was made, there's a lot of expatriate Iranians in this country, especially in Los Angeles. I got so many phone calls from radio stations wanting to interview me about that earliest wine, because they were very proud of it. And yet, you know, if you go there today, it's an iffy thing that you can get the pride or even, you know, do the sampling of the grapes for the DNA analysis. But if you want to go back even earlier in Iran, this is the earliest chemically attested wine that we've found thus far from another site in Iran. It's up in the Zagros Mountains. So the Zagros Mountains are right between Iraq and Iran. And Gogin Tepe is farther to the north. And it's in the middle of the Zagros Mountains. If you go farther north, you get to Haji Peruz. And this is where we're back in the Neolithic period,
where we get the first plant domestication, so it's possible the grape can be domesticated, but also a whole series of other plants are domesticated and animals. And we get people settling down for the first time in villages year-round to take care of the different domesticates. Now, you know, why would you want to settle down? You know, if you are successful hunter-gatherers, you know, just move around, and you still have people like this, you know, and you could make a little, you know, take some wild grapes, make some wine, and so forth, but if you really want to get serious about this, and you really think alcoholic beverages are important to your culture and religion, then you want to settle down in one place and take care of the vines or manage the fields of barley and wheat. And so this would be, I think, the main incentive for why people settle down. Eventually it gets more complex and you get civilization arising. So you could really say that fermented beverages are very much involved in the beginning of our civilization. And you still see this today in our religions, Christianity, Judaism, even Islam, because when you get to the paradise of Islam, you're going to be able to drink as much wine. And it also depends on where you are. If you're up in the hilly country, you can make wine. If you're down in the plains, unless you do a lot of irrigation and so on, you know, beer, barley, wheat in the Middle East is what's important. And then you get experimentation with pottery in the Neolithic period. So you get the invention of pottery. And it could be the invention of pottery very much tied to being able to better make wine and other fermented beverages and to store it and to serve it. Because we get all kinds of very special vessels for serving and ones that have narrow mouths that you can do the fermentation in and keep out, you know, a lot of oxygen. And, you know, different setups, really, in pottery, and especially serving, where you would want to have a sort of ostentatious serving of the beverage start to appear in this period. And so I think this is where we really can trace a lot of our cuisine and wine, but that has to be put on solid ground by doing actual chemical and archaeological investigations. So for the Haji Perus, I went back to the Penn Museum and just asked the Neolithic archaeologist that you see sitting here, not working too hard, Mary Voigt, in the kitchen of a building from 5400 BC that had six of these jars that you see on the left. And they're about 7 liters each. So you have about 50 liters, 60 liters of wine in this kitchen, and as it turned out, because then we did our analysis. And I can go into the chemical analysis, but if we're chemically challenged, you know, in those days, we used a combination of infrared analysis, liquid chromatography, and a wet chemical test for tartaric acid, because tartaric acid is the principal acid in grapes, and therefore in wine, that is unique for the Middle East. Now, if you go to China, hawthorn fruit has 5 times the amount of tartaric acid than grapes there. And you know, you have to really go through the literature very carefully to see, you know, what compounds are in each natural product, and then also how it compares to other natural products in the same region. So, like for instance, pomegranate has some tartaric acid. It's at a much lower level than grape. So for those three techniques gave us positive for tartaric acid, we assume we have a grape product. That grape product could be wine, as one possibility, but it could also be just grape juice or vinegar. And if you know, you let the fermentation go long enough, you've got vinegar. Okay, you might want to have some vinegar. grape juice is not going to stick around very long because in a very warm climate like Iran, you're going to have, and you have yeast on the outside of the grapes, you're going to get fermentation in the first day or two. So you're going to have wine without any difficulty. And wine, as they say, is integrated into the social and culture of all these people and religions. So we did an analysis of two of these jars. One had a reddish residue on the inside, the other had a whitish, yellowish residue on the inside. And they had tartaric acid, so we could assume that they were grape product. They also had clay stoppers, like I showed in that first slide for the Egyptian mural. you know, to protect the wine. So when you make an intentional, when you put together a clay stopper, which is similar to cork in that it absorbs liquid and expands, and then also we detected a tree resin from either a pine resin or a terebinth tree resin. And we know from the ancient literature and also now many samples that we've done, the idea behind putting a tree resin, mixing it into the wine, is to help as a preservative. Now, it's also an acquired taste. I mean, some people here probably would, you know, okay, it's not bad, I don't know. But if you go to Greece, and you're like, you know, moving around like we did for 2 months in the Peloponnese, stopping at little tavernas, and you're having your moussaka, well then, you know, that scene seems to work perfectly. When you're back here in the States, and when we tried to get some experimental archaeology done with some California winemakers one time, we even brought in pine resin. Sean Thacker, who's a good winemaker, right? And we got some pine resin brought back from Mexico, but he never got around to making it. And even they were complaining, the California winemakers were saying, well, if you like, you know, how'd they go? You know, seem to be poo-pooing the idea of a resinated wine. And I said, no, and they're quite the contrary. And, you know, why don't you try to make some? You know, if you believe it, if you like it so much, and then, which is what they were sort of getting at. And that still is to happen.
I have one question. It's very interesting to me that 2.5 gallons was, it's exactly the same size as a case of wine. I don't know if anybody can mention it. Yeah, it's 2.41 gallons per case. So their store of wine is exactly what we would keep in our kitchen.
We have had six of these vessels.
Six cases sounds good.
This is just an ordinary house. You know, it's like a one-brick house. If you went to that area up in Azerbaijan today, you'd see houses just like this.
Any idea how fast they would go through?
That party might go. Maybe they would be marinating lots of their gold and so forth.
Thank you.
But would they use it as a way to ensure that what they're drinking doesn't have microbes that are dirty? I mean, because the alcohol kills a lot of them.
Well, they had no means to test for microbes.
Yeah. I mean, but did they recognize if they drank water out of the stream? I mean, if they get sick and they don't get sick?
Oh, yeah. I covered that a little bit. Yeah, I mean, obviously, alcohol, you know, works very well as an antiseptic and keeps people healthier. And the people that drank wine or any kind of beverage, they would tend to live longer if they didn't get sick. And also probably do this one. And ferment beverages can also enter. It's not just social lubrication of the brew. You know, sometimes things get more interesting than just the
social lubrication.
Okay, so this is the shirt that had the yellowish residue on the inside that we analyzed from Haji Farouz going back to 5400. DC and A, you see the simple formula of tartaric acid. Now, today, we also look for citric, malic, cinnic, and other organic acids. And we use a technique called liquid chromatography, tandem mass spectrometry, which can tell us, you know, that tartaric acid is really there. Then the other question is, microbes also produce tartaric acid. So you have to take soil samples from the archaeological context and compare that with what you're finding after you do an extraction of the shirt. Now, that may have a residue on it, but a lot of times we're working with pottery that has no residue, and we're putting it through different organic solvents to bring the organic material to the surface. So if it's a liquid inside the vessel, and you can tell sometimes by the style of the vessel, whether it's a liquid container, that liquid gets absorbed into the pottery. And this is what makes pottery so important for this type of study. It lasts forever. It also is a zeolite material that absorbs and holds ancient organic materials by the ionic forces. And then when we come along and put it through a bath, boiling methanol or chloroform, we draw out those ancient compounds and then can use these techniques to start to identify what compounds are present and what natural products were there to begin with. So Once we make these discoveries with ancient wine and beer and so forth, then we start thinking, well, you know, how far back did the fermentation go? And I've already said a few words about this. This is, the next saffron here is a reference to Midas touch, because that's the bittering agent that we used for that beverage, which combined wine, beer, and mead. So here we've got a human, you know, maybe looking very intently at some brightly colored fruit, and since we're so visually oriented, brightly colored fruit would definitely attract us. Now, if we're in Africa, there are no grapes except along, you know, maybe up along Morocco and, you know, here in the Mediterranean. But if you go sub-Saharan Africa, there's no grapes. So you must be, here our ancestor or primate, you know, maybe looking at some dates or figs or marula fruit in South Africa, and might pile those into a primitive container of wood and so forth. And as the weight of the fruit, as it accumulates in that container, will cause the skins to break, juice will ooze out, there will be some yeast associated with the high sugar fruit, you get the fermentation going. And so by the time our ancestors worked their way down through the fruit, the juice, and smell the difference in aromas, different organic compounds, put their little dip with their fingers and tasted it, and or got a bigger drink, and got a buzz or a mind-altering experience. I mean, you can understand that they would want to reproduce the same process over and over again. Of course, they would be limited with fruit because it's only ripened at certain times of the year. They wouldn't have the kinds of containers that could preserve it with. So that was a difficulty. But you would end up with what could be called the Stone Age. And the sour ale there is, if you take any sort of carbohydrate, like a wild grain or stems or roots, and you chew it, we have enzymes in our saliva that will break the carbohydrates down into sugar. And then you spit it out. And I happen to think this really is a way to do it. You chew it, spit it out, let an insect come by with some yeast on it, inoculate it, and get the fermentation going. Fruits are a lot easier because you just have to squash them and get the juice, and the fermentation occurs more easily. So here we have our social lubrication going on. And we've already mentioned the medical side of this, that alcohol kills bacteria. And if you were living in a world in which you only had a life expectancy of 20 or 30 years, you were probably looking through your environment very carefully for any herbs that might help to extend your life expectancy. So herbs, like tree resins, also, were often mixed into ancient beverages, and in our ancient pharmacopoeias from China, Rome, Greece, Egypt, and so forth, these herbs are mentioned in detail. Sometimes we can't translate them, we don't know exactly which herb it is or what tree resin. But alcoholic beverages really are the universal medicine of humankind. Before synthetic medicines, all the doctors, you know, go back to the Romans, Galen, and Hippocrates and so on, they talk about wine as one of the principal ways to administer a cure. But then you also would mix into it all different kinds of herbs, like I say. And that, for thousands of years, has been the way we try to cure ourselves. I mentioned, I think, most of the other points. The other important point, I think, is the process of fermentation itself. Because not only do we have this mind-altering experience from the fermented beverages, but the ancient human could not see the yeast on the right there. That's microscopically blown up. But they could certainly observe what happened when they put the juice into a vat and it started fermenting, because you'd get all the carbon dioxide coming out of the liquid, roiling the surface. You know, so it was almost like there was some kind of a god within, you know, some extraterrestrial force. This helps explain why these beverages become so important in human culture and religion. Now, if you did the fermentation of the grape juice in that jar from Haji Bruce on the right, you might actually have the whole vessel start to move around. like there was some sort of external force at work. So these microscopic geese, you know, are pretty important to people. But they don't know what they are. They haven't seen them yet. You know, it wasn't until 150 200 years ago that, I guess you go back to Leeuwenhoek, some of the other early microscopists. Now, I mentioned a little bit about the Iranian vessels, but we also have other potential vessels from Neolithic sites in Turkey and Georgia that are very curious. Now, for instance, here we have a pottery jar that looks to be like a person with his arms up underneath a grapevine with little globules of clay representing the clusters of the grapes themselves. And on the left, you see an even earlier vessel from a site in eastern Turkey that is made out of a mineral, a clay mineral, that shows a scene, again, of people, you know, dancing with a turtle, or a tortoise in this case, like some sort of a celebration. Well, celebrations are often associated with wine and other ancient beverages. So, you know, we have samples of these that we've been working on for a while.
Where is that from in Turkey?
This one is from Nivali Chori. Nivali Chori. You know it? Yeah, it's in the eastern part of the country. It's along the Euphrates. You know, it's like in that whole area. There's other, I'll show some other slides here, another site that was much earlier than Nivali Chori, Göbekli Tepe, which is very famous now because of its temples. And which we think the beer might have been made, but it still hasn't been resolved. Now, the trouble with the Georgian sherds, and this has always been the issue from the beginning, the Georgian sherds were washed in hydrochloric acid. Well, hydrochloric acid is not good for tartaric acid. It destroys your organics. And they were very small sherds. And so, you know, at the beginning, I said, well, our tests are coming out some positive, some negative. We're not getting like a unified picture of it being tartaric acid release. And so, you know, I was always, you know, very cautious about, even in my book, you know, about how you should interpret, you know, the evidence that we're getting. And this is still, let me just say, it's still up in the air. And we have a project now in Georgia, funded by the Georgians. I could have been there 2 weeks ago if my wife hadn't had a double knee replacement. With our colleagues from France, who are doing DNA research from Copenhagen. It's a very multinational group, all focused on where the wine of Georgia came from. But, you know, all these countries want to be the first. This is the goal. Yeah, whether it's Armenians, Georgians, Turks, whoever, right? And so, you know, but we still need the scientific evidence for this, and we still don't have it. And so we've been working on this very intensively for the last couple of years at a new site in Georgia, getting new samples, working out our techniques even more cautiously, and so forth. And the same can be said about the evidence we have on grape pips. Now, those familiar with my book will know that there's a difference between the wild grape pip and the domesticated grape pip. So the domesticated is longer and narrower. But this does not always hold up. Like Pinot Noir pips are actually more like the, I don't know what happened here.
I can hear all those.
You guys are
That was his soul.
Yeah, so here's the wine. Yeah, this is the soul, right? Yeah. Coming out of our Georgian viticulturalist to
Now
we've got a ghost from beyond. But you'll see the wild grape pip received is broader and shorter, okay? But I say that Pinot Noir is that way too, so you have to be careful about distinguishing the wild and domesticated. But if you got domesticated in a group from a good context, or biological context, you know, in this case, these are from a Neolithic site, and he gave me one seed to take back. I won't go through the whole story, but it was like parting with his soul. He had some of Scott, Alexander, Drooley afterwards to celebrate. The thing you have to be careful about these seeds is you can get contamination from one, a higher layer down into a lower layer of modern seeds down into an ancient layer. Or you could have just, you know, something breaking away from the side of the bark, really cut down, and going into an earlier layer, and you have rats moving grape seeds around. And we still need to do more radiocarbon data to see if we really have domesticated grape in Neolithic Georgia.
What were the small clove-like pips on the bark, if they were in the pit? Was that wood?
Oh, yeah, that's the stem.
That's the pedicle.
Yeah, pedicle. And then, you know, why would you want to domesticate the grape? You know, why not just go out and do your wild grape collecting? Well, the domesticated grape is actually more fruitful because it has the stamens and the thistle on the same plant. So it's self-fertilizing in that flower. Whereas the wild grapes have separate female and male plants. And you have to have wind or insects transferring the pollen. But once they figure this out, and it's on, you know, these are very small. This many people here probably have gone out looking at their vines to see how the flowers are looking and setting. But it's very small, you know, and it helps you have a hand lens, you know, to see whether you have thistles or stamens or whatever, or whether it's just, you know, a wild type without it. But once humans figure this out, then they could, you know, they learned about especially horticulture, being able to take part of a plant somewhere else and reproduce it, clone it. Then they have the possibility of, you know, doing all kinds of shapes, colors, more sweet, juicier and so forth, less seeds, and you know, it really opened up a world of possibilities. You could not take the seeds though, because the seeds have a combination of, you know, the two sexes, and they can, you know, the DNA gets all sorts of, you know, switched around, and you really can't perpetuate the plant by that. You have to do use a cutting. So we've got the saffirati that we'll be taking today. We've got you know, all kinds of, you know, other varietals from this general area that are somehow related to the original domestication of the grapevine.
What biological process can convert a plant that has individual genders into forming a hermaphrodite itself in domestication? What domestication brought to grapevine in making it a hermaphrodite versus
the... Well, that's really something for a botanist to answer, but you know, they think the original plant, you know, before it split into the wild, was a hermaphrodite. And then later humans selected for the hermaphrodite again. But I don't know all the mechanicals. You have to ask somebody at Davis. I don't know. I don't see any Davis people here. Okay.
Grafting is fascinating.
Yeah. Pardon?
You can graft?
Yeah, I guess you can graft. Yeah.
So we developed this hypothesis called the Noah hypothesis, sort of in keeping with the Eve hypothesis, that, you know, maybe there was a single first mother in Africa, you know, that is, you know, really the ultimate product of. So the biblical story, you know, is similar because Noah, you know, lands on a mount supposedly Ararat in eastern Turkey. And so it's just a way of, you know, expressing, you know, this idea of a single domestication event occurring somewhere up in the Near East, mountainous region, you know, whether over in Iran, or up into the Caucasus Mountains over eastern Turkey. Now what's left out of here is Lebanon, which I think could still be very important. And we're going to be trying Chateau Massar wine, which is made in a winery, I guess, up above Byblos or further north, maybe. But the winemaker at Massar has told me, and I don't know if this is true, that there are wild grapes growing up above Byblos, which is the main Canaanite city from which they sent wine out to the Mediterranean. And really one of the most important sites in the Near East for intercommunication. But there are wild grapes supposedly growing up in the mountains there now. It would be good, but it's just like in Iran. We need to get into these regions where the grapes, the wild grapes, are still growing and determined by DNA whether we in fact have wild grapes or maybe just an escape from a domesticated grape. And so these are the three regions we've been focusing on to see if we can determine if there's a single point in time and space of the domestication of Vitis vinifera. Now, Vitis vinifera, the purplish areas show where the wild plant grows today, which is probably very similar to antiquity. And you see it does not go down to Egypt, but it does go down into southern Lebanon, northern Israel. And so when humans were coming out of Africa and taking this route up into Asia, the first place they would have seen grapes is Lebanon. And they might well have been kind of intrigued by these fruit. And they might have done similar things that they did in Africa with fruit. You know, squash, get the juice out, make a fermented beverage. So I think we still need to do a lot of work in Lebanon. Unfortunately, it's a difficult place to work. We did have a plan a few years ago to set up a wine museum out in the, some of the people are familiar with Lebanon geography. Very large valley right between the mountains in Lebanon, called the Kaaba Valley, where a lot of the fighting had to go on and so on. And so we were going to set up a wine museum out of that small valley, which has not materialized as yet. I wonder why. So there's also the sites in eastern Turkey we talked about a little bit, which could produce more evidence on where the domestication event could have occurred. These are quite early, as you see. And the one on the right is from this site around 9,000 to 8,500 BC that has temples made out of these orthostats with very realistic animal depictions on them. No grape depictions thus far. And the one on the left is from Nivali Choi with a sort of a snake going up the back of a male head. Or you can use your imagination. So then we have this null hypothesis. Now, you know, a lot of people, we still are arguing about this. You know, there could be a separate domestication over in Spain for the wild grape growth.
Right, I was just going to ask about the snake. So I was watching your YouTube video last night, and you talked about the snakes in Egypt, and the snake bodice associated with wine. Right. You see a long motif of snake. Is it associated with wine in this context, and what is the association?
Well, when they were stomping out the grapes there in Egypt, they were singing a song to the snake gods. I don't know if we had a lot of other literary evidence for that, but we do know that much. And the snakes are very tied into religion in general. I remember when we were excavating in Jordan one time, it was what's called the Palestinian viper, quite poisonous, that my workers saw. It was maybe 10 feet long. And I've never seen such a ritualistic killing in my life. I mean, they were snapping on it, and then they burned it up. So they're still growing grapes around our area, but we have no idea. This is the first presentation. This is an Armenian monastery with grapevines and vineyards around it. So then we have the wine culture hypothesis, which is that it's somewhere wherever it was first domesticated and they developed horticulture methods, they also were making the pottery to make the wine to serve it. But this culture of how you serve and make wine then spread out along the Fertile Crescent, going down to Egypt, where they didn't have the Eurasian grape, and they had to set up vineyards and so forth, and then also along to Shiraz, which also did not have a wild grape crop. So this was over the period we assume, because it's a fairly complex process, from about 6,000, 5,000 BC down to 3,000 BC, when we had our first evidence in Shiraz and Egypt of the domesticated grape. But when you have it a little bit earlier, 3150 in Egypt, and I'll come back to that site. But now we've gone up there and we've collected a lot of grapes in different parts of these areas, especially eastern Turkey. This is at the headwaters of the Euphrates River, and that's one of my colleagues from Ankara on the left,
You can see where the wild grapevines are growing. It's very treacherous at times.
Treacherous.
He's a master, he's an operating guy.
Okay, well, you know, I would have had to pull him out of the river, because what happened to me was, in this case, oh, we've got a message for you.
It's Sia.
They're joining us in a moment, but not yet.
So, it might look like a very peaceful situation that I'm standing alongside the grapevines and picking one. Well, it turned out we had wild Eurasian grape on one side, male, and female on the other side, and right in between was a hermaphroditic grapevine. So we still have that sample. We still haven't really done the full DNA analysis on it, but you know, it could tell us a lot about the earliest domestication events. Now, unfortunately, right after that photo was taken, I almost fell into the river. And it might look like a fairly calm river there, but it was during spring, and there was so much water pouring down the Euphrates that it was not a good situation. Fortunately, my friend on the left there, he had better boots than I had. He was able to pull me back. And then I climbed up the steep slope on the right and escaped. And I tore my pants and I came out of it. So we have evidence now, and this is published back in 2006, you know, with Josie DMO. You probably know him from Kansas Robinson's book on what's called the Wine Bible. Mm-hmm. Well, he's like the DNA person I work on for a long time.
Hair makes a difference.
He's not called the Wine Bible.
Wine Grapes.
Yeah, but
they were calling it
too.
They were calling it at one point. Or the Grape Bible.
Maybe the
Grape
Bible.
Yeah. Yeah. Patrick, these are religious wars.
Study we did with Josie, we had samples of wild cultivated from Georgia to the Turkey, also Europe. And when we did the DNA workup with 20 markers, microsatellites, in this case, it turned out the cultivated Europe, you know, which includes Pinot Noir and you know, a whole lot of other cultivars, you know, French, Italian, Spanish, and so forth, they were closer to the wild Turkey and the wild Georgian, and they were closer to those than they were to the wild Europe. So this is a good sign that this is where it ultimately originated. And subsequent studies, like there was one done by Cornell researchers using what's called SNPs, PNAS, has verified this. And especially Pinot Noir seems to be very involved in the understanding where the original grape came from and how it spread then across to Europe and produced the cultivars that we have today. So I'll just do a quick tour across the Mediterranean. Yeah.
Sorry, just along around that topic. So, I mean, I know that there's this question of local domestication versus similar in other fields. I know that there are rather vigorous discussions about dogs. Have they looked at some of the law and the right competes, some of the fields we use to track there?
I'm familiar with some of that, but I'll touch on it here, okay, so go ahead. Yeah. So we've got this movement, you know, of viticulture, you know, transplanting grapevine down to Egypt and so forth. And then we have this site down at the Abydos from very early, 3150 BC. You know, we can start just take a quick look really from north to south, from where I think the original wine culture started, and then going down to Egypt and quickly across to the Mediterranean. Now, Patrick Pont will be speaking more about some of this in the afternoon, so I won't try to steal all his thunder. But, of course, up in Georgia and Armenia, we have some very interesting artifacts, you could say, that likely we use for wine, such as that cup on the left, which is from Armenia, Karachan, about 2000 BC, and then this tradition of making very special vessels and other artifacts like the silver-covered vines, which now don't appear to be great vines. But they do have nodes that suggest that they were imitating that.
And then right up to the present, like this is the artist that celebrates wine and all his artwork. And of course, then we have the Quivery tradition of England, Armenia, and Georgia, which is you take very large jars, bury them underground, take the grapes with all the pips and everything, throw it into the jar, cover it up with stone, and let it sit for the next 9 months or whatever. And then you open it up and you're true to the wine. But some people might like, some people might not. I think it's very interesting, and I think this is where sort of the future aspect of my talk comes in, is we need to do more research on pottery making for winemaking. That is, how does the pottery really interact with grape juice and wine to produce something different from what we're accustomed to? Because the pottery has, like I mentioned, an ionic structure that keeps different compounds in place. So you can get enzymatic reactions, you can get other aromatics, you can get oxidation reduction in a different way, depending on the porosity of the clay. And so in this Georgian project, we're hoping to get samples of quivery from different time periods, and also from different parts of new vessels, you know, the upper part and the lower part of the base, and see, you know, what the differences are in how much tartaric acid there is, but also other aromatics, and see, you know, what sort of, this is just a start, because I don't think anybody really has done much with looking at pottery and winemaking, although now it's become quite common as the quivery has moved, I guess, even here to California, right? And people are playing around also with other ceramic materials, like Tim Mungavi has, I guess, some concrete. It's not just pottery that the actors have. So the Georgians, they always felt that they had this tradition going back 8,000 years ago. But the earliest, I don't know why it's not working. Yeah, but you can just look at it. But the earliest evidence we had, even from Georgia and Armenia, in Armenia these are called harag. You notice they're not very totally underground in this ancient site, but they had very large production units going up to 500,000 liters that were done in jars like this. This is an old photograph from an early excavation. But the earliest date on those is 700 or 800 BC. Okay. But then Reni was found, and I don't know, am I going over the time?
Yes,
yeah.
But not too bad.
Okay.
You're an hour over, it's
okay. I'm an hour over. I got some interruptions. But Reni, which we're going to taste some of the wine today, is a really spectacular site. You can see it's a cave, but it's quite dramatic. Next.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. But inside, whoops. Oh, no. But there you go. Inside the cave are what appeared to be, and has been shown by chemical and arguably mechanical evidence, to be a great winemaking facility in which you have plaster floors in which you can stomp out the grapes on. And then the juice would flow down into underground jars for fermentation. So this is dated, there's various dates on this. Some people argue about it between 4 and 2000 BC, but it's still very early, much earlier than the 700 BC evidence. So it's sort of like a stepping stone between the Neolithic period and down into later times. And that's why this is a very important site, and we're still working on it. And we hope to do some research with the Armenians on the DNA analysis. They've got a special consortium that put together, also with the Iranians, to try to get more samples for DNA analysis. And then if you go farther south, we have this site in the Galilee called Tel Kabri, which you may have seen in the news lately, which has a cellar with about 2,000 liters of wine so far. They have published some scholarly articles, but they haven't really given us enough evidence of how they detect the tartaric acid and also what the compounds in the different herbs. They have a whole series of herbs that they can put into the wine, but they haven't really given us the evidence for that. Next. And then we have a question of whether you're sort of a native grape of Israel, called Morawi, And if we're going to try, a version of this too. And there's a university up in the West Bank area, Ariel University, where a man named Drury has started trying to reproduce this grape. But again, we don't really have the DNA of it. So I'm sort of reluctant to, until we see the really scholarly backup. Next. Well, this is the 3150 BC wine, which is the earliest from Egypt that was imported from Palestine. It's a real wine cellar for the king, one of the early kings had it. So we were able to identify Saccharomyces cerevisiae by DNA analysis. So it's really the earliest wine use that we have so far. And that goes out across the Mediterranean by boat, and they had Canaanites and Phoenicians carrying wine. But wherever they would stop, if they were taking grapevines, there could be a cross with the wild grapevine in that region. And this is what we have to reconstruct. And we also have to do ancient DNA to see what's happening in each of these places at different times. Next. And then we get to did an article on the earliest wine produced in France, and it's mainly under the influence of the Etruscans. Next. There's the Etruscan amphoras with wine. And then next, eventually the native Celtic people began producing their own wine. And we had a wine press. You know, they're very small, but you know, sort of like the original Egyptian ones. You know, just you know, one person, two people get inside, and they stomp the grapes. And that had tartaric acid at an elevated level above the soil, so that was the first evidence for production of wine in France. See, that's a Roman depiction of the process. And then we go, there's been another article recently on how one made the Iron Age up in Scandinavia. That's a whole interesting process. Well, we can skip through this one. I don't want to flip it. Okay, so then we end up with, you know, this one species, right, producing 8,000 to 10,000 cultivars, and it's spreading out around the world for the last 40 years. But, you know, really, we don't know a whole lot, and we've got...
Are those ancient bag and boxes?
I took this from one of Josie's, it's not the greatest, but, you know, it kind of indicates, 99% wines in the world, right? But you know, we don't really get to taste many of these ancient varieties, or the ones that have come down to us, and that's the opportunity we're going to have today. But we need to do a lot more study to figure out what's going on. And you know, it's not just Vitis vinifera. China has more species of grapes than any other part of the world. And when I go to China and I try the wines made out of native cultivars or wild grapes, like something. In China, you know, those have unique profile. So we have a lot more tasting and aroma adventures in front of us. You know, if we're willing to take these different other species and cultivars here, work with them, and try to recreate what some of these ancient wines were. And the final one. Okay, next. So this just takes us, you know, from Rome to sunny California. But you don't have much sunny weather.
Thank you.